decidedly gloomy. And the two children were thoroughly miserable. There was nowhere to go. Nothing to do. And it was raining. "Why not go out for a long walk?" suggested Auntie. "Wrap yourself up and take these umbrellas. There's nothing wrong with two healthy young people enjoying a brisk walk in the morning rain." Belbury, Uncle's house, stood in its own grounds, about half a mile from Bridgeworth, the nearest village. There was one shop and a bus service that operated only on Saturdays. In between say, the birds never sang. They did not get as far as the ruins, however, because John's nerve failed him after he had imagined that a clutching hand had tugged his jacket from a thorn bush. An eerie sound like someone laughing in the trees was the last straw. Let's go back, he said. It's far too spooky around here. For the whole of the following day, the two were so quiet that Uncle began to worry, fearing something some more mysterious was afoot. When next morning came, a letter had arrived. Uncle read it aloud at breakfast. We are to have a guest at the house, he announced. Professor Hardy, the archaeologist, is carrying out a dig in the Abbey ruins and would like us to put him up during the vacation. Of course, I shall say yes. He is a very important man. Bushes nearby provided cover from which the children could overhear their conversations unobserved. I'm so glad you were able to come, the professor was saying. This matter is more in your line than mine. I never expected to stumble upon the graves of the old monks so soon, and I feel that I should not disturb the skeletons without special authority. I should hope not, replied the vicar. You should attempt to do so under any circumstances. The parson was finding it difficult to remain calm. You must remember that these are the graves of holy men. What would you say if some stranger proposed to dig up the bones of your ancestors? Supposing the graves are haunted, said John with a shudder. What, in daytime? Replied Jennifer. Everyone knows that ghosts only come out at night. Fortunately, the watchman seemed to be at lunch, and the two were able to tour the ruins unobserved. Within minutes, they had discovered the tarpaulin, which covered the skeletons. It was pegged down loosely in each corner. Saw beneath it five skeletons in a row, partly covered with earth, several with skulls grinning horribly. One skeleton was complete and looked particularly grisly because, unlike the others, it had been buried in a crouching position. Let's go, said Jennifer. He looks as if he's about to jump out of the grave. I don't like it one bit. Staring, fascinated. Under the skeleton lay a metal object. Bravely he picked it up. It's a cross, he said. I wonder if it's made of gold. At that moment, there was a shout, and the watchman hurried towards them, waving a stick. Run like mad, yelled Jennifer. He's after us. It was not until 5 minutes later, when they had reached the safety of their uncle's field, that John realized still clutching the cross. They examined it carefully. It was about 10 inches long and, apart from a certain amount of corrosion, seemed to be in perfect condition. It's a crucifix, said Jennifer, but I don't think it's gold. There's a big one like that in the church. Then she suddenly grabbed John and began shaking him. Oh dear, what have you done? She shrieked. You stole him from a grave. I've just remembered. If you rob the dead, follows you home. They reached Uncle's house, still out of breath and badly shaken, and washed the crucifix under the bathroom tap, afterwards hiding it in John's chest of drawers. What shall we do? Said Jennifer. We can't tell Uncle and Aunt. They'd never understand. Agreed, said John. And if the professor ever got to know, he might accuse us of stealing it. When the professor came out that evening, he gave the two a very hard look, but said nothing until dinner time. We've had trouble today at the site, he remarked. Quite a lot of trouble. It was bad enough having a couple of young intruders peeping at the skeletons, but do you know what? That silly old tramp we turned off the site came back and wanted to fight us. I've never had this sort of trouble before. If it happens again, I'll call the police. Afterwards, John and Jennifer had a council of war. They just had to return the crucifix to the grave without raising suspicion. We can't go in the daytime, said Jennifer. We'd be certain to be discovered. Suppose we were caught with the cross in our possession. Must be looking for the cross. Certain that John, in the next room, newspaper that morning and hurled it into a waste paper basket. Absolute rubbish, he growled, and at the same time saying to his wife, with all its sensationalism, the Gazette was correct in reminding him that it was his duty to ensure that the dead of the parish were treated with respect and not exposed to interference from the morbidly inclined night visitors, practical jokers, or from wandering tramps. Whoever is responsible for this outrage, they asked to stop. Silly.